I spoke with President Barack Obama's special advisor on ISIS in an international television exclusive. I began by asking Robert Malley about what he is telling the president needs to be done in order to degrade and ultimately destroy the terrorist group ISIS. Listen.
Well, we need to fight on all fronts, the military front, which we're doing both in Syria and in Iraq with partners on the ground. Much easier to do in Iraq than in Syria, given the situation there. But there's a military campaign, which we're prosecuting, but there's also an economic campaign. There's a campaign to try to make sure that ISIL cannot recruit as many foreign fighters as it has been doing so far. So this is a multi-pronged campaign, and we've been reviewing it constantly. A lot of public attention, obviously, is on the military aspect, but that's not the only one by any stretch of the imagination.
And in the last, since 2004, since this anti-ISIS coalition started bombing campaigns in Syria, ISIS territory has shrunk, but they're still making very significant gains. Just as recently as 2 days ago, they took over a key strategic town, Kanazir, in Syria on a very important military route. What has not worked in this length of time that is still allowing ISIS to make these types of gains?
Well, first, as you said, in fact, they've lost quite a bit of territory, in particular in Iraq, but also also in Syria. So there has been real progress. And even as we speak, there's a operation taking place to try to take over the city of Shadadi, which is a very important city for ISIL. So even as there's some setbacks, we're making progress now. Why it hasn't gone as well in Syria as some would like, it's because of the situation in Syria, because you have a civil war going on between a very violent and dictatorial regime, and the opposition. And that is, of course, distracting from the fight against ISIL and other terrorist groups. And until that gets resolved, or at least de-escalated, it is going to be hard to get all the focus that needs to be devoted to the fight against ISIL.
One of the things you said needed to be addressed was ISIS financing and funding. What kind of money? I mean, I'm just curious. There were so many figures that were floating around of ISIS being able to raise $1 million a day by selling oil, et cetera, et cetera. What kind of figures are we really talking about based on what you've been able to gather?
Because I don't want to, you know, this changes all the time. For example, the forces that we support that have just taken over Shadadi, they have taken over oil fields, which provided a big part of, or a significant part of what ISIL has been able to accumulate. They've also, we've destroyed some of the oil fields that they've been using to get more money. We're trying also to go after some of their cash reserves. So I don't want to give an estimate now, but we have been prosecuting this economic war against ISIL as vigorously as we've been prosecuting the military one. And our goal is to make sure that they don't have the money to oppress people in Syria and Iraq, and to plan terrorist plots in Europe or here.
But ultimately, will it require any kind of ground operation? Because on the ground, Kurdish fighters, who, by the way, the Turks are very unhappy with and whose positions they sometimes bomb, are the ones who are making true territorial gains against ISIS, this terrorist group in parts of Syria and Iraq. Do you believe that eventually ground troops in greater numbers, even from Western countries, will be necessary?
And that's not what we're talking about now. I mean, the ground troops, there are Syrians who are prepared to take the fight to ISIL. And part of the problem and the message we've been delivering to the Russians is that their bombing campaign, which is often indiscriminate, is distracting from the fight against ISIL, because they're bombing the very people who would be prepared to go fight ISIL if they didn't have to protect themselves from the regime or from the Russians. Which is why the cessation of hostilities, which we've just negotiated, and which may or may not succeed, we're doing everything in our power to make it succeed. But if it does succeed, and if you see a cessation of hostilities between the regime and the opposition, then both could go fight ISIL, and in particular those that we are backing, that opposition, could go fight ISIL.
You're such an important part of representing the United States at some of these talks. Do you believe that it will lead to a situation that Russia is invested enough, that all warring parties are invested enough, that it will lead to a true difference for civilians on the ground?
Listen, I could give you a million reasons to be skeptical. If just look at the last 5 years, that gives you ample reason to doubt what the regime will do, what Russia will do, and what their allies will do. So we're not going into this with a naive hope that it's suddenly going to get much better. But we are going into this with the notion that we need to do everything we can to put the chances on our side that this does work for the sake of the Syrian people, first and foremost, and for the sake of the fight against ISIL and for regional stability.
There have been many reports that Vladimir Putin has himself been personally invested in trying to make this cessation of hostilities a reality, at least on the most basic level. Is this something you've observed in your role at the White House, that Vladimir Putin has been more involved?
He has certainly taken ownership of this. He asked to speak to the president on Monday. He made a nationwide televised address. So at least on the surface, he has a lot invested in the success of this enterprise, which hopefully will put some pressure on the Russians to get this right and to put pressure on the regime. Again, we'll have to see whether they do it. They have not lived up to some of their commitments in the past, and we hope that this time they will, because, frankly, they have something at stake, a lot at stake here, too, because they should not want to get involved in an open-ended quagmire in Syria.
And he's the one who asked to speak to President Obama.
That's right. He wanted to make sure that both leaders were on the same page when it came to the deal that we had just negotiated with them, and to then be able to tell his own public and the world that he was committed to it. Well, the world will judge.